Good afternoon, everyone. This is Werner Ness, member of the Business Committee of JavaCard Forum, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this fifth webinar from the JavaCard Forum 2021 webinar series. I hope you enjoyed the previous presentations, and if you could not attend, please feel free to watch the replay of the previous webinar presentations on the JavaCard Forum website. Today's topic is a presentation from Jill Bernabeu from Global Platform on Global Platform's Secure Element Protection Profile and FIDO 2.0 extensions. Secure elements are used in a wide range of application and business areas, but all of them require a high level of security. Jill will introduce Global Platform's Secure Element Protection Profile and how it standardizes the security definitions of the different options and features available on a Global Platform certified secure element. He will also demonstrate the latest alignment of the protection profile to FIDO 2.0 requirements. Jill Bernabeu is Global Platform Technical Director, as well as Technical Advisor for the Standardization and Technology Department at Thales. In this role, he supports Thales marketing and product groups to deploy trusted and convenient digital services. Jill was elected as Global Platform's Technical Director in 2005. And has ever since driven forward the development of Global Platform specifications to deploy secure services. Jill also acts as Global Platform central technical liaison point, coordinating the efforts three technical committees, the Secure Element Committee, the Trusted Execution Environment Committee, and the Trusted Platform Services Committee, as well as the Global Platform Task Forces with external partners. We will answer your questions at the end of the presentation. You can enter them either in the chat box during the presentation or wait until the presentation is finished when we will unmute the microphones. Please also note that you will receive links to the webinar presentation recording and material by email shortly after the presentation. And now, without any other further delay, Jill, please, the desk is yours.
Thanks a lot for the introduction and for the invitation. I'm very proud to be here to talk on behalf of Global Platform members and participate to the JavaCard webinar series. So today I will talk about Secure Element Protection Profile and FIDO extension. But before, I would like to give some context of these initiatives. So Global Platform is looking on the deployment of the technology on secure component all over the world and in different markets. And we recognize that there is a big trend today, and we are talking to more and more device manufacturers that are not used to talk about security. So this is a big change for Global Platform products. They are embedded by people that may not have the same knowledge of our, we'll say, legacy customers such as banks, governments, mobile network operators, etc. So there is a need to position and to explain what does it mean using a secure component. So on this slide, we have a different initiative ongoing related to all the effort that Global Platform is doing. So of course we are still continuing to work on the secure component technology. So secure element, now we are looking for MCU, and definitely the secure element protection profile is part of this secure by design effort of Global Platform. We are also helping device manufacturer to integrate or to embed a secure component and to connect that with the OS, with application, which is called the device trust architecture. And we have a lot of initiative regarding certification, where also this protection profile fits. The last part of our initiative to help device manufacturer is related to the usage of the device in the field, such as secure device onboarding, such as updating the device on the field, and of course, decommissioning. Why we think it's very important to help device manufacturer is that the device manufacturer, again, doesn't have a strong knowledge of certification, but they need to answer to a lot of regulation in Europe, in US, in UK. In most of the country today are publishing a regulation for IoT that give to the device manufacturer a lot of responsibility regarding the data that are stored within the device, such as the GDPR in Europe, but also some engagement that the device will not become a threat to other devices. Like in IoT. So part of this effort, we have looked at the different ecosystem and the current market, and we see that globally there is three levels of security which is currently defined on the different markets. So we have looked all this thanks to our collaboration with PCI, EMVCO, FIDO, and here again, you see the FIDO which is appearing. We have a lot of collaboration on the FIDO TEE, and I will talk today about the collaboration we are will open with FIDO on the SE. So we are talking about the FIDO L3 for the TEE, and the FIDO L3 Plus for the secure element. But there is other market, such the banks, such the some requirement in the industrial work, where we see that there is a strong need of these three level of security. So we have been working to really base our strategy related to these three levels. And in order to discuss with, I will say, people that doesn't have a strong knowledge of security, we think that using the VAN level, VAN it's vulnerability level within the common criteria, we will be able to clearly help device manufacturer to select the right choices. And typically, we think that the low level should be VAN 1 and VAN 2, the medium level of security should be VAN 3, and high level should be a VAN 4 and VAN 5. This is important because everything is secure, but we think that splitting and separating the different solutions based on the robustness against attack is a good way to explain what is secure, what is more secure than secure, and what is less secure than secure. Again, everything is secure, so it's very, very important to provide some clear guidelines about the different solutions. So we have within Global Platform three levels. Again, we have been publishing and working on the TEE protection profile for a while. And what I will present today, it's what we have created for the secure element, which is a high level of security. And so to answer to markets such as payment, ID, or high level of secure monitor within the industrial world. The secure element protection profile is really new. We didn't have so far a way to have a definition of the different assets that needs to be protected, nor the security features that are very important and are the core of the technology of Global Platform. So this is something very new that has been released the beginning of the year and been certified within the common criteria scheme, and that I will present today the main structure. So what is the protection profile? So of course, the protection profile follows the common criteria specification. I will not enter too much about what does it mean, but this is very important for you to understand that we have a standardized way now to describe the evaluation of a secure element. So we have a standardized way to clarify which assets need to be protected, what are the threats, what are the security objectives, and the security requirements for a secure element supporting global platform. And this is important because we have a core feature of global platform that are used in many markets, in the banking market, in IT market, on the cards, but also on embedded secure elements that are embedded within devices. And there is no reasons to have a card that are evaluated differently than embedded secure element, because they are all supporting the same asset, the same thread, the same security objective, and the same security requirements. Most of the tools that are available to crack a banking card are available to crack an embedded secure element into the device. So at SUSE, the global platform technology apply in all the market, and it was very, very important to have the same way to describe, again, all the part or the security for the evaluation. We think that this will simplify the evaluation work for vendor and for labs. Why? Because today you need to describe all the security feature under a document that is called a security target, and it's an activity which is quite complex and need the labs to check and double check that the security target is compatible with the common criteria rules. Here, you have most of the security target that has been pre-approved, pre-validated by the publication of this protection profile. So all the analysis about the scope, assets, and extra now can be used by a vendor, and the labs will accept this because, again, this has been already pre-validated during the evaluation of the protection profile. This also will simplify the work of certification authority. If you are a certification authority and you want to integrate a secure element in some part of a regulation, the only way to do that is through a protection profile. So certification authority will be able now to use this protection profile as a basis to certify the secure element. And also, something which is also important, this will help to choose between products because now all the secure element may be evaluated with the same baseline, and then it will be more simple for issuer to select two products with the same scope of evaluation, which was not the case in some cases on some market, because each and every vendor may define the security target in a different way. So everything is related to the card content management, which is a generic term that Global Platform is using and to describe how to load, install, delete, move, update application in a dynamic multi-application post-issuance world across multiple actors. So how we have done that? In fact, we have an application native stack, which is available today in most of the secure element. We have the chip, we have the execution environment, we have all the global platform card framework that provide the solutions, and on top of that, you have application. The secure element protection profile follow exactly the same structure. There is something related to the chip, and the chip are going and getting evaluation related to a specific protection profile, which is a BSI CCPP 0084. So it's a well-known protection profile that is used by all the chipset manufacturers providing tamper-resistant elements. We have the Java Card Protection Profile open configuration, which has been published by Oracle, thanks to the Java Card Forum activities that describe the execution environment. And on top of that, we have the Secure Element Protection Profile that include all the Java Card Protection Profile features, because we need everything provided by Java Card, and describe all the security domain, card administration, security channel, etc., etc. And I will, of course, come back to that. So if I'm going to a more description, you have here outside of the protection profile, but required by the protection profile, the chipset that should follow the PP84 in terms of certification. You have all the assets and elements of the Java card system. And on top of that, you have the GP framework with the security domain and all the things. And the red dotted arrows, square, show the scope of the secure element protection profile. So all the features of global platform now can be used from the protection profile. There is no need to write a specific security target for that. We are in global platform following a lot of market, from banking cards to embedded secure element. So we have decided to have something very, very modular, so we are able to use the same document in very various environments. So the first brick of this protection profile, it's the core of the protection profile. So the core of the protection profile covers, in fact, all the data that must be supported and managed by, I would say, a card. So what we call the repository for the people that knows the global platform technology, we have open. Open is really all the library with all the features. We have the security domain. And we have, of course, the secure channel communication, so the secure protocol. All the security secure channel protocol must follow a certain level of requirement in the specification, and of course, must follow the same or similar security requirement within the protection profile. So this is really the core that is available in all the cards, and of course, it's the very the basis of this protection profile. Open the card application lifecycle management, managing privileges, the trusted framework to be able to manage potential effect between application, and the secure channel protocol. On top of this core PP, we have six functional packages, which is enhancement of the way that the card is performing. So it's not as such new features, it's more extensions. Within these six functional packages, you find the Cypher load file data block. So it's a way to load encrypted load file within global platform. You have global services. This is an optional feature to allow an application to provide services to the other application. You have the cardholder verification method, which is a way to manage the end-user authentication. So in most of the cards, this is the PIN and the global PIN. And then after, you have some additional feature to manage the card that are related to delegated management. So and when you are allowing certain actions by some other actor within the card, and DAP verification and mandated DAP, it's a way to verify that the load file that has been loaded within the card has been checked by someone. So as you see, it's not a specific feature, it's just an additional feature of the core. So again, we have the core, we have the six functional packages, and then after you have some optional features. And within this secure element protection profile, and compliant with the latest version of common criteria, it's possible to create what they call PP module. Again, this is optional, I will say autonomous feature that may or may not be present into the product. The first optional feature, it's the confidential card content management. So this has been created to be able to create security domain over the air and to load keys, the primary keys of the security domain protected by a third party. We have a module for the contactless services, again, in the contactless card or in a contactless smartphone. The end user may want to deactivate some application. So the use case in the contactless smartphone is that you may have loaded two banking applications, and sometimes you want to pay with the bank A and with the bank B. So this requires to have specific services to allow the end user to do that. Inside these services, there is also a lot of automated selection based on template extra. I do not want to come back to that, but the main objective of these contactless services is to add additional information related to the management of the secure element contactless mode. Just for your information, I think there is more than 50% of the smartphone in 2025 that will have an embedded secure element that is managing contactless. So it's a very key feature in the smartphone and the premium smartphone. Executable load file upgrade. This is also new and it's coming from the connected world where potentially you have some update to do on the application, on the applet, and you want to be able to back up all the data of the applet, load a new version of the applet, and to be able to retrieve all the data of the applet. So this is what we call the executable load file upgrade that is available functionally on Amendment H, and that all the requirements, security requirements, are defined on this module. The last PP module of the Secure Element Protection Profile, it's what we call the Secure Element Management System. It's a way to manage and to give authorization to manage a secure element with a script based on authorization that has delivered by someone which is able to again, have the rights within the card. So this is published for a long time now, and we have a specific module to cover the specificities in terms of assets that needs to be supported if your secure element support the same features. So a core, six options, four modules, and there is a last one, which is the OS update. So there is a strong demand today on the market about being able to update the OS. So to fix some issues or to add some specific features. So this is now strongly recommended into the EU CSA, the Cybersecurity Act, where all the object, IT object should have some update capabilities. And this is also now part of the EUCC, the implementation of common criteria in Europe that is compatible with the EU CSA, the Cybersecurity Act. So on the right of this slide, you have three versions. We are not covering the right part, which is the full OS update, because this is already included within the protection profile PP84. In fact, to be able to load a full update, you need to have the loader which is outside the OS. And outside the OS, there is no global platform. And by the way, this is supported for a while on the PP84, what they call the loader 2. So the full update is not here. We are covering two cases that are on the left part of this slide. As you see on the two cases, the OS update loader is within the OS, which makes sense because this is what we are evaluating thanks to the SC protection profile. So the OS update add code on top of the product. So at the end of the day, you will have the initial product plus the update, or the OS update is able to load new code inside the current code. And as you see, the OS update is within the blue dark part of the OS. So these two different models of web update are covered thanks to this additional module of OS update. So voilà, as you see, a very modular approach to be able to cover all the different possibilities to use the global platform secure element technology, from card to ID document to embedded secure element in premium iPhone. Something very simple to use, because either you support the feature and then you have the standardized description of the feature, either you don't support it and then you don't need. So the writing of the security target, it's strongly simplified for the vendor and of course more simple for the issuer to select the right product corresponding to the selection of features. So Global Platform is really working a lot with other organizations that are using Global Platform for applications, such as banks, such ID governments, and extra. And with this new Secure Element Protection Profile, we have decided to look if there is applications or new applications that need to have some kind of acceleration, I will say. And this is where we have been looking for FIDO 2.0. So I have just one introduction of FIDO 2.0. The intent today is not at all to describe the technology, but FIDO 2.0, so it's the recent version of FIDO that provide a new integration within the device, a lot of web services to connect the web engine to the FIDO. And there is also a possibility to have an authenticator which is outside the device. So in the FIDO 2 specification, there is again the authenticator which is within the platform. So typically, if you have a Windows 11 device, the camera is managed by Windows and the FIDO 2 authenticator is provided by the OS. But you have also the possibility to have a USB token or smartphone or a watch that connects to the device and performs the FIDO features. This is based on the new specification and the last version of this new specification called Client to Authenticator Protocol, so CTAP version 2.1 has been published this summer on the June. And again, this is where really Global Platform is active, because most of the USB token implementing FIDO 2 or the watches, the smartwatches, are supporting today a Global Platform secure element. So the scope of the FIDO 2 on secure element is a document that that will certainly be a protection profile that focus about developing what they call off-device roaming authenticator on a global platform secure element which is compliant with the SC protection profile. So we are not talking about the FIDO client application that may be, that may reside on the OS. We are not talking about the server or the relay party. We are talking really about this authenticator developed on top of the secure element. Because of the secure element protection profile requirement and the FIDO requirement, we are targeting VAN 5 for SE plus all the requirement, and we reach the level 3 plus of FIDO. So this is really a document that combine the global platform secure element protection profile requirement for the platform and the FIDO level 3 plus requirement for the authenticator. So this is the TOE will be the hardware, of course, the firmware, because we need it, and the software that define the secure element authenticator. I'm not saying that this covers the applet, because potentially you want to develop the SE authenticator as an extension of your OS. So this is very quite open, the way that you will implement the FIDO 2.0 application. But of course, this is the way it's to have a SE secure element protection profile apply on the product and also add an application, an applet that does the FIDO authenticator. So, voilà, we are been working on with FIDO because we have a long discussion and experience of discussing with FIDO thanks to our collaboration with the TE. So the TE has been aligned to fully cover the L3 level, and we will soon share the document with FIDO to be able to really have a collaboration and to be able to have again to simplify the certification of FIDO2 authenticator on top of the global platform secure element. So this is what I wanted to present today. Really, this protection profile offer a standardized way to define the security and the security features of a secure element. So we hope that this will help security laboratories to evaluate more products in front of the new mandate of the different countries. And of course, this protection profile is fully compliant with the European Cybersecurity Act and the EUCC, which is very important for the future, because this will rule the world of the European, I would say, the European security evaluation. This is also important because this standardized way to clarify the product will help as a vendor to accelerate and to have something which is validated in terms of security features. And of course, the device manufacturer or the issuer have a strong way to now verify which product support which features, which is very important in their view of the creating the trustworthiness of the devices that is needed to create chain of trust for a root of trust. So this is important to know exactly what kind of features are supported or not within the device. Again, it's optional. It's not that you must support all the features. The issuer will be able to select the secure element based on the feature they need. So this is very important to have this document that really address the need for a consistent and verifiable security across as a product. And again, this we hope that this will help to clarify again what is secure, what is not secure, which is on today's world very important to be able to differentiate products, but also to protect the product that are very consistent and are supporting a lot of features versus other. And based on my first drawing, to really clarify what is high level of protection and what is what level of robustness versus other protection profile that does not have the same requirement in terms of robustness of against attacks. Voilà, so this is what I wanted to share with you today, and it's a good time for questions. And I think there is already one question on the chat. I don't know if there is another question, Wesner.
I think there is a question on the chat.
Okay. So.
Oh, I think there's the second one.
Yes. Okay. So the first one, the difference between options and module, both seems to represent extension to the core PP. So yes, this is extension of the core PP, but so module is a new term that has been created within common criteria that clarify real options. And typically, if let me back on the slide, all these features are just adding additional services with the same assets. So there is no new assets, it's just additional. So this can be managed as a functional package. So you are explaining within the common criteria world that globally you are just using the feature that already in the device, in the TOE, to do something new. and it's a functional extension, but there is no something new in terms of crypto, Thread, and Extra. And this is typically the case if you're able to manage keys, and if you are to manage verification of the certificate, you are able to manage DApp. So DApp doesn't need something very new in terms of assets and extra. It's just additional key, but it is core, and it's only a specific way to use the certification of a certificate. So this can be managed as a functional package. But here we are talking about new assets, and you are talking about features that are really additional. And this is where the module are needed, or not needed, but it's a way to really show that this can be developed, how can I say that, independently. So adding card confidential content management is not an extension of everything that was stated before in terms of assets, thread, and extra. Of course, it's an extension in terms of feature, but not in terms of assets. In this case, common criteria allows you to use module. So module is it's new in the galaxy of common criteria. I don't know if there is a lot of protection profile that are using that, but this was our choice because typically the four features that you have here are very, I would say, optional. So this is a good tool for us to be able to describe some optional features.
There is another question.
Maybe the mapping between configuration and the SPP options module is straightforward, but do you plan to have this mapping added in the GP configuration? So this is a very good question, Patrick. And I'm very happy that you asked the question, but this is not planned. So some configurations are very straightforward, and typically the SE configuration takes all. So this is very, very simple. But typically on the IoT configuration, we have not said that only the core is needed. So this is not done yet, and this can be done easily. I don't know if there is a need. We have discussed about that, but we have preferred to rely on the amendments that are maybe more clear to clarify the feature. Sometimes the configuration are different from some options of the implementation of the amendment, not the amendment itself. So we have not done it. Maybe we will do it one day. This is a good question for the SE committee, Patrick. And thanks for asking.
Yeah, thank you.
Jenna, I have an additional question. There are a lot of certification schemes in the world. I think you mentioned already EMVCO, IKEA, and others. Do you think there is a benefit for the SE platforms with such a GP certification when these mandatory industry-related certification processes are additional to be performed?
So, yes, I think, again, the global platform technology, SE technology, has been evolving a lot. And if typically you have a banking card, I think this is very important that the EMVCO clarify what are the features that are mandatory on the banking card. And now it's more simple to be able to say that, okay, for a banking card, you must support this and this and this and this. So in this case, it will be great that, and this is my intent, and by the way, to go and to discuss with GSMA, with EMVCO and Extra, now that the document is published, and to say that this is, I would say, as the same as you have the specification with different options, and you are picking and choosing the options. Now you have exactly the same in terms of security certification, and this effort must be done to ask EMVCO to clarify exactly what they need in terms of security feature. So yes, this is very important.
I think there is an additional question from Patrick. when you say SEPP includes JavaCalPP, I guess you are just referencing JavaCalPP, not duplicating, refining any of the security requirements from the JavaCalPP. Did I understood it correctly?
You understood correctly, Patrick. Yes, our intent was really to use what has been published before and to rely on that. So, and is mandatory. So is really an inclusion in terms of mandatory. So you must have all the assets of the JavaCard open configuration to be able to do that. And it's, of course, we are not doing a copy and paste. We are pointing to the elements and description that are within the JavaCard protection profile.
So there is another question. Why DSM GP amendment F is not included as one of the four PP modules?
So it's a good question. In fact, DSM is a specific use of SEMS and SCP 11. So SCP 11 is part of the core technology, and these SEMS use part of the SEMS. So normally you have everything, but yes, we have not created a specific document again because SCP 11 was part of the core. But core plus SEMS should cover DSM. There is nothing additional here.
Okay, thank you. Then the next question, question on page 12, update in the field. The middle picture looks to me that you even allow overwriting of code. Is this perception right?
Yes. So again, this is possible that when people are talking about patch, they are going into the memory of the OS and they are changing part of the memory. It can be as a potentially just changing a data or changing a part. So yes, it's possible to overwrite code. And this is what we want to support, the two cases. Either you add code in the memory and you are pointing on the old OS to this new code, or you are able, because you are in specific environment, and you are able to patch inside the code. So the two are supported. For the security assets and the way to protect an extra, this has no big impact. There is a big impact in terms of functionality, definitely, but no impact in terms of security certification. Thanks, Manfred, for the question.
Thank you. I think no further question. If you have no further questions, I would like to thank Jill again for this interesting presentation. And what I mentioned in the beginning, all registered participants will receive the link to this webinar presentation recording and material by email shortly after the presentation. Be aware that there are another two interesting presentations in this week as part of the JavaCard Forum 2021 webinar on Wednesday the 15th and Thursday the 16th. Please don't forget to register. And now thank you for your participating this webinar presentation. Finally, I wish you a pleasant day or evening and hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.